Good morning and welcome to our service of worship for Sunday the 23rd of August. Our scripture today: I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the mercy of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. And so we pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that as we worship today, the appeal that you give to us to worship you and to follow you may become very real and practical for us, that we may be blessed and challenged and given more of your adore resources. For Jesus' sake, amen. Our opening hymn is Dear Lord and Father of Mankind, after which we will have our confession, followed by our Bible reading from Romans 12, and then we'll have another hymn, Morning Has Broken, recorded by Ross Palmer, and several tracks all overlaid together. So we begin with Dear Lord and Father of Mankind. Come to our confession together as we meet in the name of our Saviour, who is the one who invites us to confess our sins because we are so in need of mercy and forgiveness. So we pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we've sinned against you and against one another in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Let us worship the Lord. All praise to his name. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
The reading is taken from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 12, beginning at verse 1. Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the other. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. This is the word of the Lord.
Like the first morning.
And so we come to our notices. First of all, don't forget the giving opportunity on the website or to give online. Second, today we're worshipping today at Ellisfield at 11 o'clock and Brown Candover at the same time. Next week it's 11 o'clock at Farley or 11 o'clock at Bradley. There are prayer and Bible reading diaries available now on the website for anyone to use. You know, I've been producing this for quite a long time, a couple of Bible readings for every day and a prayer for each day. And it helps those of you who've never done systematic Bible reading. There's some really good stuff we're wading through at the moment in the Old Testament and in the New. And sometimes I want to read on to see how the story develops. Next week will be our last online service. Now that services have restarted in our churches, now's the time to go back live. Thank you to all of you who responded to the question we posed about this last weekend. And clearly all the responses so far have all been, yes, it's time to finish the online services, but thank you for them. I'm grateful to all those who have watched them, and I hope you've enjoyed them, and I hope too you've learned something about walking with Jesus in a different context in the services we've done. And maybe you've learned a new hymn or two as we've tried to just broaden the spectrum of worship. So that's our notices. And so our sermon. Let's pray first of all. Holy Spirit, we ask you to teach us and we ask you to encourage us for Jesus' sake. Amen. Well, we're going to be looking at that passage from Paul's letter to the Romans that was read to us a little earlier in our service. Paul's letter to the Christians at Rome comes first in the Apostle section of the New Testament, although it was not written first. It's a masterful exposition of the Christian faith and covers the whole range of the person and work of Jesus, the place of the law of God in relation to God's mercy and grace, the place of the Jewish people in God's plan for salvation, and then the last few chapters contain practical application of faith to life. So we're going to chapter 12, verses 1 to 2. It's Paul's appeal to his readers that in the face of the previous 11 chapters of explanation of God's plan, therefore, we are called to offer our bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. Christian faith is about how we use our bodies. We are not antinomians who think it doesn't matter how we behave or what we do with our bodies, because God is only interested in our souls. That's a Greek idea, not a Judeo-Christian one. It's one of the things that exists in our society today, particularly with some people who call themselves Christians, who have a view of the use of our bodies which is different to that which is quite clear from Scripture. Paul knocks that whole idea on the head in chapter 6. How can we carry on sinning? By no means. He who commits sin is a slave to sin. We are called to live holy, moral, godly lives. This ties in with a passage from Matthew 16 where Jesus calls us to take up our cross daily, to die to our own desires and the baser things that sometimes come at us from our hearts, and to let him be Lord. He faces us each day with choices between his way or ours, choosing to walk in prayerful dependence with him or on our own, between selfishness or selflessness, and between short-term gain versus long-term loss. Christians are called to live differently and in defiance of the hateful cultures around us. You see, we have a different Lord. We live by different morals. We live by a different worldview. And our allegiance is not to an ideology, but to a person. Paul explains all this in his letter. Growth into maturity as Christians happens when we allow the Holy Spirit to transform and change our thinking, our worldview, our cultural assumptions, and our perceptions about God. His will for our lives and how we can please Him in the way we behave flow out of our changed and transformed minds. So first, is God getting from you all He should? He begins, "I appeal to you." It's a challenge to listen, to choose, to decide, to be different. Don't be a conformist, be a non-conformist, says he, an Anglican vicar. To many people, they want to merge with their people groups, especially young people who want to belong. And it's tough when they find their values are disdained and they are accused of intolerance just because they don't go along with the woke culture, where to disagree means you are excommunicated. If we are to be real believers in Jesus, we are recipients of God's mercy and grace. I don't know whether you've ever done something so wrong that you feel terrible, and then the person you've wronged forgives you, shows you mercy, and gives you another chance. Mercy is withholding punishment from one who deserves it. Grace is giving to someone what they don't deserve. Both are what God does to and for us in Jesus. If we say we are Christians, does God get His full value from us? Our undivided attention, our unswerving loyalty, our uncompromising commitment. Walking with Jesus demands sacrifice. We live in a culture of being too comfortable and not wanting to stand out. We are challenged here to be living sacrifices, daily living in surrender to Christ, choosing to be identified with Him in our dying to what is ungodly and living to what is holy. Verse 2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that you may be able to test what is the good and perfect will of God. So how do you know the will of God for your life? When you have a renewed mind and a transformed character, you will have a clear and clean conscience that will enable you to know God's perfect will. Do you want a renewed mind? That takes both grace and effort. How do we train our minds to think Christianly? To be holy in our thinking, our meditations, our secret thoughts. The scriptures talk about make every effort. If we are drifting through life with no program to improve our thinking, advance our understanding, then we are not disciples. If we're reading Christian books to challenge our thinking, then our minds are renewed because we're being forced to think differently. I just started reading another C.S. Lewis title, which I picked up on holiday the other week. C.S. Lewis has got some brilliant things to say, and I think we all ought to be reading some of his books, even though they may be some decades old. They are classics. If we're not reading Christian books to challenge our thinking, then either we think we've arrived and that we've got nothing new to learn, or we're stuck in the past and we are not equipping ourselves with the tools to in the present to work out how to discern the latest fads and to identify what is good and what is contrary to God's mind and His way. Are we engaging in Christian discipleship where our attitudes, our perceptions, our assumptions and our worldview are being moulded by God's revealed truth? Or are we going along with current cultural and other assumptions, many of which run counter to God? What do we each do to grow as disciples of Jesus each week? Anything? Second question. Are you getting from God all you should? How much heartache, how much regret, how much frustration, how much disappointment flows out of a lack of heartfelt prayer individually and corporately, gaining access to God's grace, mercy, truth, hope, strength, life-enhancing joy is what he offers us. Are we making the time to gain what he offers to us freely, or have we settled for less than the best? Do we not want to be disturbed in our cozy security blanket? A hymn writer wrote this: what a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. That's a simple thing. I'll leave you with those two questions, and next week we're going to pick up on the rest of Romans chapter 12, where we're going to look at a couple more questions. A prayer. Father, we ask that as we reflect on Romans 12, asking that question whether God is getting from us all we should and whether we're getting from him all we could. Help us, Lord, to find all the things and resources you have for us, but to make the effort for Jesus' sake and his glory. Amen. So, we're going to have in a moment our creed, our declaration of faith. That will be followed by a meditation hymn called There's a Quiet Understanding, which will lead us into our prayers. And then we'll go on to our final hymn. So we declare our faith in the words of the shortened creed. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. There's a quiet understanding when we're gathered in the Spirit. It's a promise that he gives us when we gather in his name. There's a love we feel in Jesus. There's a manna that he feeds us. It's a promise that he gives us when we gather in his name. And we know when we're together, sharing love and understanding, that our brothers and our sisters feel a oneness that he brings. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Jesus, for the way you love and feed us, for the many ways you lead us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Let us pray for the church and the world, and thank God for his goodness to us. Almighty God, who called your church to witness that you were, in Christ, reconciling men and women to yourself, help us so to proclaim the good news of your love, that all who hear it may be reconciled to you, through him who died for us and rose again, and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for those who devote their lives to your service. We pray for your wisdom, guidance, boldness for all Christian leaders, especially for Archbishop Justin Welby, Bishop Tim, and here for David and Stephen, that they would be bold in their witness to you and your love. Also, we pray for all church leaders in countries where there is persecution, hunger, war, poverty, oppression, and illness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We pray for our world. We pray for wisdom for the leaders of the nations as they deal with difficult global, political, and economic challenges. We pray especially for Belarus, for a just resolution to the unrest following the recent election. We pray for the Lebanon, and we ask that you would bring healing and restoration of hope, as well as the physical rebuilding that is necessary. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. We pray for our Queen and her family, for Boris Johnson and all those involved in governing our country. We pray especially that you, Lord, will guide us as a nation through these difficult times, and for a fair and just result for all those being awarded their GCSEs and those who have their A-levels adjusted. We also pray for your guidance in the negotiations with the European Union. O Lord God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. We give thanks for all those who serve our communities and ask for your guidance for them, particularly for our MPs, our borough and parish councillors, all teachers and those who contribute to school life, our local policeman Andy Reed, and for all those who work in the Candover Valley stores. We remember those who are ill, suffering or bereaved, particularly Jean Ryden, Peter Padmore, Doreen Lonergan and Bunny Priestley. We pray that they would know the comfort of your healing presence with them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, your heart of love is seen in Jesus on the cross as he bled and died for us all. Help us to be your hands at work with hearts of your love in the world that we are a part of. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us spend a moment or two in private prayer. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now let's say the prayer that Jesus taught us in its modern version.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
And so we come to our final hymn, Jesus is King and I Will Extol Him. And after that, we'll have our blessing. So we come to our blessing, for God always wants to finish anything of worship with a blessing. And scripture, time and again in the Old Testament, we find things should end with a blessing. And here's your blessing today. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. So go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen. And we will see you, God willing, next week for our final installment and episodes of Online Church. God bless you.